So it's 11 o'clock. So let's start with the workshop today. A very good morning to all of you. I'm Dr. Tanya Bose, Associate Professor in Department of Applied Sciences. In this tough and critical time of COVID-19, through which the entire human civilization is passing, our department has visualized the opportunity to utilize this lockdown period to conduct this 5 days live online workshop on MATLAB, an introduction with applications. I would like to thank Dr. Mohit Kumar Kakkar, Assistant Dean, Department of Applied Sciences, to take this initiative and encouraging me to organize this live workshop. I would also like to thank IT department for providing the facility of webinar, which has brought all of us together. We have got an overwhelming response, and 85 participants from various departments have registered for this workshop. I thank all the participants for joining this webinar. So let's begin with the first session. So before I begin with the session, I would like to note, please note down my email ID so that whenever you have any doubts, you can drop down your emails to me at this address, and they will be replied within a day, or maybe I will take up in the next session. Okay, so let me start. The outline of my presentation today would be starting with MATLAB, MATLAB Windows, how MATLAB acts as a calculator, the elementary built-in functions, the scalar variables, and how to write the script files. Now let's start with MATLAB. Now when you install MATLAB on your desktops, now what is MATLAB all about? MATLAB, it is a very powerful language for technical computing. It integrates computation, visualization, and programming in an easy-to-use environment where problems and solutions are expressed in a familiar mathematical notation. The name MATLAB stands for Matrix Laboratory. MATLAB has evolved over a period of years with input from many users. In university environments, it is the standard instructional tool for introductory and advanced courses in mathematics, engineering, and science. In industry, MATLAB is the tool of choice for high productivity research, development, and analysis. Now, where can MATLAB be used? It can be used for maths computations, for modeling and simulations, for data analysis and processing, for algorithm development, and visualization and graphics. Now, let's start with the MATLAB Windows. When you install MATLAB on your desktops, you get to see this view. So you can see the screenshot of a MATLAB window when you open. And in this window, you can see that there are four windows, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Let me explain you what are all those windows about. The first window that you see is command window. Now, what is command window? It is that window where you write all the commands, and the output is shown also in this window. The second window is command history. All the commands, all the variables that you will be using in this command window, they will be logged on here. So whenever you want to see whichever command you are using, you can go through the command history. It will let you know about all the commands and all the variables that you are using here. Then the third window is current folder, where you are saving all these files while you are working in MATLAB. They are saved in the current folder. So it is being shown here. You can see that C drive is shown, then program files, MATLAB. This is where the MATLAB is installed in my desktop. Otherwise, when you are running a program or you are executing a program, where you are saving it, it will be shown here. So later on in the next few slides, you'll come to know about it. And the last window that you can see is the workspace. All the variables that you will be working with in MATLAB, they will be stored in workspace. So anytime you can go through the workspace to view your variables. Next is So whatever I've explained you, it has been explained here. Command window, it is the main window which enters the variables and runs the programs. Command history, it logs the commands entered in the command window. Workspace, it provides the information about the variables that are used. And current folder, it shows the files in the current folder. Now, in addition to these four basic windows, you can also see a figure window, editor window, and help window. So maybe in the next few slides, I'll tell you about all these windows one by one. So for the time being, you should know about these four windows. That is command window, command history, workspace, and current folder. Now working in current command window. Now when you work in command window, whenever you're going to write a command, you always have to place your cursor after this prompt symbol. So you can see two arrows here. So to type a command, the cursor is placed next to this command prompt. Now, what are the working rules while you are working in a command window? To type a command, the cursor, this is the first thing you should keep in mind. The cursor always should be placed next to the command prompt. Secondly, once the command is typed and the enter key is pressed, the command is executed. So suppose you're writing a command, you have to press the enter key to execute that command, otherwise it won't be executed. And whenever you write a group of commands line by line, whenever you press enter, always the last command is executed, right? Okay. Now you can also write the commands in the same line, but then you have to put commas in between the commands. And when you press the enter key after the last command, it will be executed in the direction from left to the right. It is not possible to go back to a previous line that is displayed in the command window, make a correction, and then re-execute the command. So this is a limitation when you're writing the commands one by one. So if you want to, suppose you have written four lines and you want to make some correction in the second line. So you cannot go back to the second line and make correction. You again have to type it again, and again you have to execute that command. You have to press enter for it. But then there is a shortcut. If you want to execute the command written in the second line, you can use the arrows that are marked in your keyboard. With the help of the up and the down arrow keys, you can, MATLAB, it recalls those commands, and you can just press enter. It will show you those commands and then you can press them, right? And if a command is too long to fit in one line, it can be continued to the next line by typing three periods, that is known as ellipses, and then pressing the enter key. The continuation of the command is then typed in the new line. The command can continue line after line up to a total of 4096 characters. This I'll show you in the next slides. How do ellipses work, right? Okay. Now, what is the role of semicolon? When a command is typed in the command window, the enter key is pressed and the command is executed. So whenever you're writing a command, so you have to press enter to execute it. Now what happens when you write a semicolon after that command? Let's see the screenshot. See, I have written A is equal to 5 and I'm pressing enter after this. So it is displaying me the output that the variable A has been given the value 5. Now look at the next line. I'm writing A is equal to 5, semicolon. I've pressed enter after it. No output is shown. Look at the next line. B is equal to 6. Again, semicolon, I've pressed enter after it. I've moved on to the next line. Again, the output is not shown. Look at the next line. C is equal to A plus B, semicolon. I've pressed enter. Then I'm writing again C. So MATLAB knows that I have to display what is C, because after C, there is no semicolon. That means what is the role of semicolon? Semicolon will allow MATLAB not to display the output in the next line. It knows that I have to store it, but I don't have to show the output. But when after writing C, I'm pressing enter, there is no semicolon here. So it is giving me the output as C is equal to 11. That means semicolon will stop out the output of that command, right? So if a semicolon is typed at the end of a command, the output of the command is not displayed. So when is it used? So typing a semicolon is useful when the results is obvious or known, or when the output is very large, right? If several commands are typed in the same line, the output from any of the bit commands will not be displayed if a semicolon is typed between the commands instead of a comma. So if I write a group of commands, suppose if I write A is equal to 5 semicolon, B is equal to 6 semicolon, C is equal to A plus B semicolon in same one line, nothing will be displayed because all are stored. They are not to be displayed. But if I put a comma, I'll show you it in the next, maybe in the next few slides, how does comma and semicolon work together. Now, what is the meaning of typing percentage? What is the meaning of percentage symbol? Look at the screenshot. A is equal to 5, semicolon. I've pressed enter after it. In the next line, I'm writing percentage B is equal to 6, semicolon. You can see that the text has been marked as green, right? Then after that, in the next line, C is equal to A plus B, semicolon. And then it is writing, then I'm writing C and I'm pressing enter. So accordingly, according to the last slide, it should give me the value of C. But MATLAB is showing you an error, undefined function or variable B, and hence undefined function or variable C. Now just think for a second, why is this displayed? That means what is this percentage symbol doing? This percentage symbol is just commenting this line. It does not want MATLAB to execute this command. That means this line is no longer there, right? So if this line is no longer there, what does it mean? That if A is equal to 5, we move on to the next line, C is equal to A plus B, and MATLAB does not know the value of B. And hence it is defining me that B is an undefined function or a variable. And if B is undefined, automatically C will also be undefined, and hence undefined function or variable C, right? So I think you understood what is the role of commenting or what is the role of this percentage. So when the symbol percentage is typed at the beginning of a line, the line is designated as a comment. So this means that the line is not executed when we press enter, right? So whenever in a program, so this is useful when you write a long program. So in that, if you want to write something on your own or you want to comment some lines, you can always use percentage symbol. Okay, next is the CLC command. Now what is CLC command? CLC means clear screen. Clear screen means that suppose you're working on your MATLAB command window. You have written so many commands and at the end, you think it is a hodgepodge and I want to erase my command window. So if you write CLC and you press enter, you will find this as your command window. So the entire thing has been erased, but if you remember my first slide, there were two more windows along with it, the command history and workspace. Nothing will be erased from command history and workspace. So whenever you want to use certain commands or certain variables, you can always go to those windows and you can use the arrow keys or you can double click there. So to get back the commands or the variables into your command window. So clear screen will only clean your screen. It will not erase the variables or the commands that you have used before, right? So the CLC command, it clears the command window. After working in the command window for a while, the display may become very long. So once the CLC command is executed, a clear window is displayed. The command does not change anything that was done before. If some variables were defined previously, they still exist and can be recalled with up arrow key that were typed before. So you can always use the commands that you have already rewritten. So you don't have to write it again and again. With the help of the arrow keys, you can use them again and again, right? Okay. So we have, so far we have just got to know that when you open a MATLAB window, what all you get to see and where you need to write or type the commands. So the commands are typed in the command window and you also get the output there, right? Now let's look at the first application of MATLAB, how MATLAB is used as a calculator. So there are certain rules how MATLAB is used as a calculator. If you remember your junior mathematics, right? So when we were solving algebraic equations, so there was a Bodmer's rule. So Bodmer's rule said brackets first, then off, then division, then multiplication, then addition, and then subtraction, right? So you have to give a preference to all these brackets first, then this and that. But similarly, when you use MATLAB as a calculator, there is an order of precedence for each of these commands. What is that order? The first preference is given to parentheses. That means if there are brackets, they will be solved first. For nested parentheses, the innermost are executed first. Then the second preference is given to exponential. So if there is certain exponential term present in your command, in your function, it will be executed in the second place. In the third place, multiplication and division, they are given equal preference. In the fourth place, addition and subtraction, they are given the last preference, right? So first is parentheses, second is exponential, third is multiplication and division, fourth is addition and subtraction. Let's see an example how MATLAB is used as a calculator. Look at the first line, 7 plus 8 by 2. So what will be executed first here? When I write 7 plus 8 by 2, I have to press enter after it. When I press enter, my answer is 11. How is my answer 11? First of all, if you look at these operations, there is division sign and there is addition sign. So division will be given the first preference. So 8 by 2 is 4, then 7 will be added to 4. So what is your answer? Your answer is 11, right? Okay. Now look at the second line. 7 plus 8 divided by 2. Again, I press enter. Look at the same expressions are there, but I put a parenthesis in 7 plus 8. So first preference will be given to parentheses. So 7 plus 8 is 15. 15 divided by 2, my answer would be 7.5, right? Look at the last command in this screenshot. 4 plus 5 divided by 3 plus 2. So here we have addition and division. So division is given the first preference. So 5 by 3, it will be solved first. My answer would be 1.6667. Then in that answer, 4 and 2 will be added. So your final answer would be 7.6667, right? So I hope how MATLAB is used as a calculator. Let's look at the second screenshot. Look at the first one. 5 exponential 3 divided by 2. So 5 exponential 3 will be solved first and then the answer will be divided by 2. So your answer would be 62.5003. Look at the next example. 27 raised to power 1 by 3 plus 32 raised to power 0.2. So first of all, parentheses would be solved. 1 will be divided by 3. Then the exponential places will be solved. Then whatever answer you get here, they will be added and your final answer would be 5, right? Look at the next one. 27 exponential 1 by 3 plus 32 exponential 0.2. So here, what should be solved first? First of all, we will solve the exponential parts and then the answer will be divided by 3 and then it will be added, right? Okay. So you can see that just a parenthesis changes your answer to such a huge content, right? So this is the preference rule should be followed while MATLAB is used as a calculator. Okay. Now, if you remember the working rules for MATLAB window, the command window, I told you about ellipses. Now, this is an example of ellipses. Look at this command or the function that I'm writing here. I want to execute it, but it is a huge line. So it is not fitting into one line. So what happened? After writing all these commands, I've written three dots, I've pressed enter, and I've continued with the line in the next one. So these three dots, they are known as ellipses. So according to the order of preferences, parentheses will be solved, then exponential will be solved. Then wherever there is division or multiplication, that will be solved. And later on, addition and subtraction will be done together. So the final answer executed is 0.7071, right? So now I think the three dots ellipses are clear to all of you. Okay. Now, what are the elementary built-in functions in MATLAB? The first elementary built-in function that we will discuss today is square root function. Look at the screenshot. Square root 64. Here, 64 is acting as a number, right? So square root 64, the answer is 8. Look at the second example. It's an expression written here, 50 plus 14 into 3. So first of all, according to the order of preference, 14 into 3 will be multiplied, then the answer will be added to 50, and then square root of that answer will be taken. So your answer will be 9.5917. In the next line, you can see that a function is there, square root of square root something, right? So first of all, square root 100 will take place, the answer will be 10, then 9 into 10, answer will be added to 54. And then whatever answer you get, you'll get 144. Then square root of 144 will take place. So your answer will be 12, right? Look at the next one. Here the function is included in an expression. It is in the form of an expression. 15 plus 600 divided by 4, square root of 121. So square root of 121 will be 11. Then division, first of all, parentheses will be solved. And then it will be divided by 11. So your answer will be 15. So these are a few examples how the square root built-in function is used in MATLAB, right? Now there are some more built-in functions. Square root we have discussed. So for square root, the format is you write square root SQRT and you write the number in parentheses. That will give you the answer. You can see the example here. Square root 81 is equal to 9. The second one is nth root of a number. So the format is you have to write nthrot x comma n. So you can see the example here. So this function, what will it do? It will take the real nth root of a real number x. So nth root of the number is 80 and you have to take the fifth root. So the answer is 2.4022. Look at the next elementary maths function. It is exponential x. So the format is exp. In brackets, you write the number. So it will take the exponential of that function. So exponential of 5, 148.4132. Next, absolute value of a function, of a number, sorry. ABS, then in brackets, you write that number. So let's see, ABS of minus 24. So absolute value means to take the positive of that number. So your answer is 24. The next built-in function is log x. Log x means natural logarithm with base e. So you have to write it as log. Suppose I want to take of 1000. So the natural logarithm of 1000 would be 6.9078. The next elementary function is log to the base 10 for the number x. So log 10, log 1000 to the base 10, the answer would be 3. The next elementary function is factorial x. So factorial x, like factorial 5, I have to write it like this, factorial, in brackets you write the number, so your answer would be 120, right? Okay. Now there are certain elementary functions for trigonometry also. So if I write sine x means I have to take the angle in radians. So like sine pi by 6, my answer would be 0.50. So I have to write pi like this, pi. Similarly, if I write sine dx has to be used if your angle is in degrees. Similarly, cos x will give the value of cosine of that angle in radians. And if I write cos dx, the angle has to be taken in degrees. So if I write cos d30, my answer will be 0.8660. Likewise, I have the commands for tan x, tan dx. Again, the angles are to be taken in radians and degrees. We can see this example. Tan 5 by 6, the answer is 0.5774. Then cot x, cotangent of angle x, x is in radians. And if the angle is to be taken in degrees, so it has to be cot d 30. So the answer is 1.7321. Likewise, we have the built-in functions for inverse trigonometry also, like a sin x, a cos x, a tan x, a cot x. They are the angles in radians, and a sin dx, a cos dx, a tan dx, a cot dx for the angles in degrees. The hyperbolic trigonometric functions are sin hx, cos hx, tan hx, and cot hx, right? Next is the elementary functions for rounding functions. Look at the function first one, round x. What will round x do? It will round to the nearest integer. Like round 17 by 5 is 3, right? So 17 by 5 is approximately 3.4. So it will round off to 3. Look, fix x. It will round towards 0. So fix 13 by 5. 13 by 5 is 2.6. So it will, your answer will be 2. Now you must be thinking then, what is the difference between round and fix? Now what is the difference between round and fix? Like suppose if I write round 2.6, my answer would be 3. If I write round 2.4, my answer would be 2. That means whatever number is written after the decimal place, if that number is bigger than 5, it will round off to the next integer, right? So if I write 2.5, 2.6, 2.7 or 2.9, it will always round off to 3. But if I write the number 2.1, 2.2 till 2.4, it will round off to 2, right? But in case of fix, the decimal part is chopped off. Whether the decimal place is bigger than 5 or less than 5, it will be chopped off. So if I write fix 2.5, my answer would be 2. If I write fix 2.4, my answer would be 2, right? So it will fix, it will just chop off the decimal place, right? So I think you got the difference between round and fix. Now the next is seal. Seal x, it will round towards infinity, right? So seal 11 by 5, 11 by 5 is 2.2. So it will round towards infinity. It's towards the ceiling, it will round off. So 2.2, so it will seal to 3. And if I use floor x, it will round towards minus infinity, right? So it will go towards the floor. So floor 2.2 would be 2, right? So seal will go towards the upper bound and floor will go towards the lower bound. The next rounding function is remainder x comma y. So the format is REM. In brackets, you write the values of x and y. So remainder x comma y means it returns the remainder after x is divided by y, right? Okay. So remainder 13 comma 5. So when you divide 13 by 5, what is the remainder left? 3. So it will give you the remainder 3. The next rounding function is sin x. Format is sign. In brackets, you write down x. It's the signum function. How does it work? If the value of x is greater than 0, it will return the value 1. If the value of x is less than 0, it will return the value minus 1. And if the value of x is equal to 0, it will return the value 0. Right? So for numbers greater than 0, the answer is always 1. For numbers less than 0, the answer is always minus 1. And when the number is equal to 0, it will always return 0. So let's see the example. Sin 5, this is greater than 0, so your answer has to be 1, right? So these are the rounding functions. Next, we have scalar variables. Now, how do we put values in the variables, right? First of all, let's see what are scalar variables. Once a variable is assigned a numerical value, it can be used in mathematical expressions, in functions, and also in MATLAB statements and commands. A variable is actually a name of a memory location. When a new variable is defined, MATLAB allocates an appropriate memory space where the variable's assignment is stored. When the variable is used, the stored data is used. But if the variable is assigned a new value, the content of the memory location is replaced. Now, how to assign values to the variables? The assignment operator is equal to sign. How do we assign it? We write the variable name, we put an equal to symbol, and whatever value that variable needs to take, we put that value here. So if I want to write x is equal to 5, so if I want that the variable x need to get the value 5, so I will write x is equal to 5, right? Okay. So let's go to the working of an assignment operator. Look at the screenshot. I've written x is equal to 15. Let's recall whatever we have done so far. X equal to 15 and I'm pressing an enter. What will happen? X, the variable x, has been assigned the number 15. But if I put a semicolon after this and I press enter, then what will happen? It will not be executed, right? It will be only stored. It will not be displayed in the MATLAB window. Look at the next one. X is equal to 3 into x minus 12. So here I'm changing the value of x. X, this 15 will be stored here, and whatever answer, 33, will be now the new value of x, right? So a new value is assigned to x and it is 3 times the old value minus 12. So this is how the assignment operator works in MATLAB. Now let's check this example. A is equal to 12. So I'm assigning 12 to the letter, to the variable A. And when I press enter after this, it is showing, it is displaying the output that the variable A has the value 12. Then B is equal to 4. So I'm assigning 4 to the character B. So then I'm pressing enter after this. When I press enter, the variable B has been shown that it has been stored as 4. In the next one, I'm writing this expression on the right hand side. So the values of A and B will be put here and 18 will be stored in the variable C, right? Okay. The same example, but the technique of writing it in the command window is a little different. So now let's see what happens. A is equal to 12, semicolon. B is equal to 4, semicolon. C is equal to this expression, semicolon. So once I press enter after this, nothing is displayed. So it shows that MATLAB needs to store them, but it has not to display the variables. And in the fourth line, I'm writing C and I'm pressing enter. There is no semicolon after this. So it will show the value of C, right? So this is another way of writing the commands. So it's your choice how you want to write the commands in the MATLAB command window, whether you want to display them one by one or you want to write it in one go and then display the final output. That is your own choice. There is one more way of writing these commands. What is that way? Let's see. See, I've written all the things in one line. And I'm using commas and semicolons. And here I've written nothing. So what will happen? When I press enter after this line, I told you in the very beginning how does the command window work. It starts executing the commands from left to right, right? So first of all, it will go to the first one. A is equal to 12. There is a comma sign. So it wants that you should display the answer. So it is telling you that the answer of A is 12. Then the next one is B is equal to 4. There is a semicolon sign here. So semicolon will prohibit the output. So this is not shown. It will move on to the next one. C is equal to this expression and there is nothing after this. So again, the output will be shown. So C is equal to 18, right? So there is a semicolon sign. So therefore, the output of B is not there, but A and C will be displayed on the screen. So I hope you got the difference of how to write these in three ways. Okay. Now the last part of my section was how to write script files. Now so far you have seen that how to write commands in the command window. But I told you there is a limitation. Suppose after writing 4 or 5 lines and you press enter after each line, you got to spot a mistake in the second line and you want to make a correction there. It is not possible there. You cannot write it, right? You cannot rewrite that command or you cannot make correction into the previously executed line. So there, the script files are used. So what are script files? Now let's see. Moreover, when you are writing the commands in the command window, you cannot save your commands there, right? So you have, suppose you want to use those commands somewhere 2-3 days down the line. So you again have to write those commands because you haven't saved them. There is no option for saving those commands. So this is where the script files play a role, right? So let's see what are script files. The commands in the command window cannot be saved and executed again. A better way of executing the commands with MATLAB is to first create a file with a list of commands, save it, and then execute the file. So it is always advisable in MATLAB, so because you're not going to do these elementary operations in MATLAB, you need to write some programs, and a program always contains a couple of lines, right? So it is always advised to save those lines, those commands, and so that you can execute it again and again whenever you want those, or you can make correction in those lines whenever you need them. So when the file runs, the command it contains are executed in the order they are listed. If needed, the commands in the file can be corrected or changed, and the file can be saved and run again. So files that are used for this purpose are called script files. There are certain notes about the script files. What things should you keep in mind while you're writing in a script file? A script file is a sequence of MATLAB commands, also called a program. When a script file runs, MATLAB executes the commands in the order they are written in the command window. When a script file has a command that generates an output, the output is displayed in the command window. Using the script file, it is convenient because it can be edited and executed many times. Script files are also called M files because the extension .m is used when they are saved. I'll show you all these things while in the next slides. So the main thing is that the script files are also known as programs, and the way you write the commands in the order, the same way it is executed, and the output is always shown in the command window, right? And when you save those files, the extension used is .m. Like you, when you're working in Word file, the extension is .doc or .docx. When you're working with a PDF file, when you save it, you get extension .pdf, right? So likewise, whenever you write a script file and you save it, the extension is always .m. Okay. Now, creating and saving a script file. Script files are created and edited in the editor window. So if you remember in my first few slides, I talked about the 4 windows and I told you that in addition to these 4 windows, there are 3 more windows: figure window, editor window, and help window. So now let's talk about what is the editor window and where it is seen. So this is the screenshot of the MATLAB when you open it up, and under the home tab, you can see the first thing written as new script. So when you click onto this new script option, the editor window is opened, right? Or you can open it through new script, or you can go to the new tab. You can press here, a drop down menu will be shown, and you can open a file there, right? Okay. So now when you open here, when you click enter, or you click it through your mouse, this is the screen shown. So this is your editor window, right? So whenever you open a new editor window, a name untitled is written here. because you haven't saved anything. So this is by default given by MATLAB. When you save it, you can rename it according to your own wish, right? Then next, you can see that the commands are written here, line by line. They are also numbered. You can see that the cursor is placed at the first line. So once I write something here, when I press enter, the cursor will move on to the next line and the next number 2 will be shown here. So whatever number of lines you write, those numbers will be written on the leftmost side, right? Okay. So these are the line numbers. Now let's go through this program that I've written in the editor window. This is a program to calculate the roots of a quadratic equation. Since many participants are not from the math background, I would like to recall what is a quadratic equation. A quadratic equation is an equation having degree 2. So this is how a quadratic equation is written. A into x square plus b into x plus c is equal to 0. So the coefficient of x square is a, the coefficient of x is b, and the coefficient of the constant term is c. So if I want to find out the roots of this equation, look at the first 3 lines. These are comments. Recall the percentage symbol. Percentage means when I want to comment some lines. I don't want these lines to be executed by MATLAB. So this is an example of a script file. This program calculates the roots of a quadratic equation and I've written the quadratic equation as ax squared plus bx plus c. So after every line I'm pressing enter, so I move on to the next line and you can see that the numbering are written here, 1, 2, 3, right? So the program starts from the 5th line. I can start it from the 4th also, but just to create a gap, I've just pressed an enter. And you can see that I've given the values of the coefficients. I've given the value of a as 4. B as minus 9, C as minus 17.5, right? And then the value of the discriminant, this is a rule of how to calculate the discriminant. It is square root of B square minus 4 into A into C. And then the first root, X1, is calculated as minus B plus discriminant. This needs to be solved first, so I put a parenthesis. Divided by 2 into a. And then the second root is calculated as minus b minus discriminant, again in parentheses, divided by 2 into a, right? So this is how we write a script file. So if I write the same thing in, I can also write it in the same way in command window also. But what will happen? It will execute it once. And suppose if I want to make a correction in the values of A, B, and C, I cannot do it because it is already executed. So again, with the help of the arrow keys, I have to rewrite them, right? But in a script while, when I save this, anytime, anywhere, if I want to make a correction, I can make the corrections here, right? So this is how you type the program in a editor window. Here, so these are the comments. And this is how we have defined the 3 variables. And these 2 values are calculating the roots of the equation. Now the next job is how to save it and how to execute it, right? The 2 things. Let's focus on how to save the script file. So remember, in the last slide, what was the name of this file? Untitled, because I haven't saved it yet, right? So now let's see what happens. So under the editor window, editor tab, I have 3 options, new, open, and save. So I will go to the save tab. I will right click it. A drop down menu will be opened here. In that, I will click the first option as save, right? When I click save here, what is the next window that I'll see? It will ask me, where do I need to select this file, right? Where do I need to select the script file? So it's my choice. I can save this file in the desktop or in any drives, right? So I can quickly go through this menu and I can click there. Suppose right now I'm saving it in D drive. So I've selected D drive. And then I'm selecting, I've created a new folder as MATLAB Webinar 2020. And I need to open it up. And when I open it, it will ask me by what name I want to save it, right? So you can see that D drive has been selected, MATLAB Webinar 2020 selected, and it is asking me what is the file name. So I have given it the name Roots, right? And you can see it is being saved with the extension .m. So when I press save, what will happen next? In the editor window, the untitled version has been renamed as roots.m. Okay? So I think it is clear how to save the files, how to save the script files. So we have created a script file. We have seen how to write in a script file. And then we have seen how to save it. Now the next job is how to execute this file, right? How to check the output. So running or executing the script file. So a script file can be executed either directly. There are two ways, right? Either you can directly do it from the editor window by clicking on the run icon. So after you have saved the file, your file has been renamed as roots.m. You can check this option here, run. So you can go to this button and you can click it. When you click, you will find the command window, the screen, right? And the answer will be displayed here. This is one way of doing it. What is the second way of doing it? Come to the command window and just write the name of the file that you were working there. So you don't have to write the extension, it is understood. So just write roots. So I've written roots and I have pressed enter, right? So these two things I've done. I've written roots and I've pressed enter. What happens? Now there are two things to be kept in mind. The first thing, if the current folder is the same drive and the folder where you were working with, it will display the answer there only, right? But if the current folder is not D, right now you can see that the current folder is, if you remember, I have saved roots in D drive and in the folder named as MATLAB Webinar. So if this is not the current folder, it will not execute the file. Then what will it do, right? Then it will display this prompt. It will tell you to change your folder and add to the path. So you have to change the folder and add to the path. And when you do this, what will happen? It will give you the output in the command window as x1 equal to 3.5 and x2 equal to minus 1.25. So I'll just repeat this step. What happens is, if on writing the file name roots and pressing enter, if my current drive and the folder is the same one in which I was working, that means the D drive, the folder, and in the current folder the same script file is shown, it will execute the command there and then. But if my current folder is not this, then it will ask you to change the folder and add to the path, right? So when you change the folder and add to the path, it will execute your program and it will display the commands, the answers, right? And if you look into the screenshot, just observe all the four windows. In the command window, the output is shown. In the command history, the name of the file is written where you were working here. Because I told you in the beginning, in the command history, all the commands and the variables that you are working in the command window, that are being logged here. But since you have not written anything here, right? I have written roots twice here. So that is why it is displaying 2 into roots. So roots are written twice. Similarly, in the current folder, the file that you were working, roots, that is being shown. Here, the current folder is being shown to you. And go through the script file. What were the variables you were working with? You were working with A, B, C, discriminant, dis, and the values of X1 and X2. So all these are shown in the workspace, right? So I think you got a clear picture how does a MATLAB window looks to you, and when you write a basic program in MATLAB in a script file, how it is saved and how it is executed, right? So that is all for my first presentation today. So if you have any queries, you can drop your mails to my email address, tanya.bose@chitkara.edu.in. And thank you so much. We end the session here. I hope you understood the basics of MATLAB today. See you tomorrow at the same time. Till then, take care, stay at home, and stay safe. Bye.